Okay, so in the last class when I mentioned about motor control, yes guys, please, shall we start? So in the last class when I was mentioning about motor control, there were a lot of questions because I also introduced current control VSI, so I thought I'll start from there, then migrate to space vector modulation. That's what I was thinking. So I told you that V by F control for any AC motor, maybe induction motor, maybe synchronous motor, it doesn't matter. But in general, we are going to have omega is proportional to the frequency. Whatever is the speed at which it is going to run is going to be approximately proportional to frequency in the case of an induction machine, whereas it is exactly proportional to the frequency in the case of a synchronous machine, right? So if I want a particular value of speed to be achieved by the machine and I'm implementing V by F control, this could be an open loop control. I'm not going to really take any feedback. So I'm not talking here about current controlled VSI. I'm directly talking about a PWM based VSI, which will allow you to adjust the frequency as per the requirement of the speed. But because we want to operate it at constant flux, we said that we are assuming that E by F equal to V by F. That's what we are assuming. So if I want this particular speed, first of all, I will be able to calculate what is the frequency, and correspondingly, I would be able to calculate the voltage. So frequency and voltage calculation can be done based on whatever is the speed that I want. So the moment I calculate the voltage, I would be able to calculate the modulation index, that is amplitude modulation index directly. So I would calculate from here amplitude modulation index. So the moment I calculate these two, that is the frequency and the amplitude modulation index, I should be able to generate the sine wave and the triangular wave if I am talking about an analog electronics implementation. If it is a digital electronic implementation with DSP or something like that, it should be able to calculate the PWM pulses directly. So I would say this can lead to directly sine wave and triangular wave generation if I am talking about analog circuit implementation. And then from here, this is going to go to the PWM pulse generation circuit. So sine wave and triangular wave will be compared, and then I have to probably give it to a comparator plus and minus, and then I would be able to generate the pulses, and I have to generate dead band also. Dead band, I am not really giving the details here because we just talked about this very briefly. So this output will go to PWM pulse generation. So this is generating the pulses. Now this pulse will be actually 6 in number if I am talking about, you know, a 3-phase inverter. So this is actually going to have 6 such pulses, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all the devices will be fired. And then finally, I'm going to give this to the VSI. So if this is my VSI, now this will be connected to the AC motor. I'm not writing specifically induction motor. It could be induction motor or synchronous motor, right? So whatever I have shown so far is all control electronics. But on the other hand, I definitely need to have the power here. So I will have an electrolytic capacitor. I will have a 3-phase rectifier. Normally uncontrolled, because in VSI, as I told you earlier, we are going to use a diode rectifier. Generally, we do not use a thyristor rectifier. So this will be an uncontrolled diode rectifier, and I'm going to have the 3-phase supply here. So this is 3-phase 50 hertz supply. So I am starting off with 3-phase 50 hertz supply from the grid, giving it to your rectifier, rectifying it, filtering it with an electrolytic capacitor. So this electrolytic capacitor, I may have plus here and minus here. That's why I'm showing the polarity, because it's not an AC capacitor, it is a DC capacitor. So plus and minus I have to show. I can't reverse the polarity. If I try to reverse the polarity, it will blast, right? So I'm going to have this as the electrolytic capacitor, which is filtering out, and its output will be given to the voltage source inverter, and the voltage source inverter pulses are generated by the control scheme that I have shown. So this is completely open loop. We are not checking anything. If I want really this to be implemented with current control, then I have to go with current controlled VSI feeding an AC motor. So this will be a closed loop control. So let us see how this could be implemented, right? So in this case, I necessarily need to take the feedback of the AC motor current, or VSI is feeding the current to the AC motor. So either VSI is output current or the motor's input current. I have to sense that. So I would again start with, maybe this is going to be my reference speed, right? And I have to compare this with the actual speed. How do we get the actual speed? Maybe we will use a tachometer you guys have used, but that is read by a human being. Tacho generator is what is normally used to sense the speed. Tacho generator is a small generator which will be coupled to the same shaft. Whatever you have seen in the machines lab, you would see one pole which is indicating the speed in digital quantity. That is essentially a tacho generator from which the signal is going, and it is counting like how many revolutions are happening with the help of the EMF that is generated. So tacho generator is a small scale DC generator which will actually generate a small voltage. For 1000 RPM, it may generate 2 volts, 3 volts, something like that. And that will be directly given to a digital indicator, like a voltmeter. That's it. So now the speeds are compared. Whatever is the speed error, that will go to a speed controller. The speed controller can be a PI controller, PID controller, whatever is the kind of controller you want to adopt. You can adopt that. It can be a digital controller. It can be an analog controller. You can implement the same PID with anything, analog or digital implementation. It can be advanced controller like ANN or fuzzy logic. So many types of controllers are employed. Now, this output is going to tell you whether I should increase the current or decrease the current, RMS value, or whether I should increase the torque or decrease the torque, so that the current, the error in the speed is bridged, the gap is bridged. So if the speed happens to be higher than whatever is the reference speed, then I have to probably generate lower torque so that it decelerates. If I'm going to have the speed to be lower, then I have to generate a larger torque so that the machine accelerates, right? So this is going to decide, I would say, either the torque reference or current reference. Either way is fine, right? So let us say I am looking at electrical quantity. So current reference I can take as the value what I have got. From this, I should be able to generate 3-phase current reference. That is, for example, if I say that the RMS value what I want is 5 amperes, right? That 5 ampere can be mapped as 5 root 2 sine omega t, 5 root 2 sine omega t minus 120, 5 root 2 sine omega t plus 120. So I should be able to map this RMS current value into the 3-phase reference currents. So this is essentially 3-phase current reference generation. So it is going to generate 3-phase currents. So what I get out of this is IA star, IB star, and IC star. If I know the torque, I should be able to back calculate the current. So either I look at the torque reference directly or current reference directly, right? I've taken the current reference in this particular case. Now, I have to compare these three currents with that of the three actual currents. So this may be IA, this may be IB, and this may be IC. All the three-phase currents have to be compared with the three-phase reference currents. And normally, we use a current controller called hysteresis current controller, which I would like to explain very briefly, which we will see in detail when we do drives course. Okay? In hysteresis current controller, normally what will be done is, if let us say, this is my reference current value. Right? This is my reference current value. IA star is this. I want to adhere to this current as much as possible as I am actually impressing a voltage upon the motor. Right? But if I try to exactly adhere to this value, I might have to turn on and turn off the devices infinite number of times, which is definitely not possible. So that is the reason why I'm going to give a margin, like a hysteresis band. So I'm going to essentially give a margin which is on the positive side as well as negative side. So what I'm going to say is, if this is IA star, I have to remain within IA star plus delta I or IA star minus delta I. I do not want to exceed this margin on either side. So if I take 5 ampere as my peak current, so 5 sine omega t is going to be my current. From that, I can probably go 0.5 ampere on the higher side or 0.5 ampere on the lower side. I can fix the margin 10%, 15%, 20% or 2%, whatever. So I'm essentially trying to fix a margin. So if I actually try to turn on, let us say, device number one, because it is A phase, I'm talking about two devices. One is one, the other one is four, right? Similarly, three, and I'm going to have six. Then I'm going to have five and two. These are the devices in the VSI or voltage source inverter. And I'm going to have the DC voltage connected from here, right? If I turn on one, the positive terminal is connected to the A phase. If I turn on one, the positive terminal is connected to A phase. If I turn on four, the negative terminal is connected to A phase. So if I connect the positive terminal to A phase, the current will start increasing. If I connect the negative terminal to A phase, the current is actually drained, so I'm going to have reduction in the current. So I will look at the present value of current. Maybe my present value of current is somewhere here right now. Okay? It is almost on the brink of the minimum value of current which can be allowed. So obviously I have to now start increasing the current. So for increasing the current, I will have one turned on. If one is turned on, the current is going to increase. How fast it increases or how slowly it increases depends upon the R and L value, what I have connected, and also the DC voltage that I have connected, right? The transient response always depends upon all these things. So I'm going to have increase in the current value like this. Now it has almost reached the brink of the maximum value of margin that I have allowed. So at this point, I have to turn off that one and turn on 4. So I would turn on 4 and turn off 1, and during that time the current will now start decreasing. And again, once it hits the minimum value, I'm going to turn on 1 again. So it is going to increase, decrease, increase, decrease. So I'm just showing as though this is the kind of current waveform that I'm going to get. So the control of current is essentially done in this manner. In most of the cases, this is what we adopt for controlling the current. So we are essentially looking at the present value of current and the reference value of current that we have set. And of course, it is not going to switch at a constant frequency. Because it doesn't exceed the value, it will not switch. If it doesn't go below the value also, it will not switch. So I'm going to essentially have the current waveform, what I get will be like a serrated waveform. It is not exact sinusoid, but the smaller the band is, I will have, it will be, the current waveform will be closer to the sinusoid. And the switching will happen very, very quickly, right? So this is essentially hysteresis current control. We call it as hysteresis because we give a band, that's all, nothing more than that, okay? So it doesn't have anything to do with your hysteresis phenomena in electrical machines or iron losses or anything. So we call this as hysteresis band current controller or hysteresis current controller. So this, if we are implementing for all the three phases, clearly I'm going to get the firing signal either for 1 or 4, 3 or 6, or 2 or 5. That's how I'm going to get. So I'm calling this as hysteresis current controller. Now what comes out of this will be actually 6 signals, because either 1 will be on or 4 will be on. So both of them have to come out. One will be at one stage, the other one will be at 0, right? So they are not of each other in the same leg. So this is coming out. Now this will go to the VSI, right? Now this is going to the VSI. Now I have to show the power side. I have so far shown only the control side. Right? So the power side essentially will look somewhat like this. I'm going to have again, DC. Sorry, I have to erase this. Okay. So I have to show essentially DC coming up here. And here is the capacitor with plus here, minus here. Of course, there will be a three-phase rectifier. I am taking it as though it is a large capacity drive. So I am taking three-phase input. If it's a small capacity, I can go with single phase. Large capacity drive, so it is going to have three-phase. And this is three-phase 50 hertz input. Okay. Now what is coming out of the VSI, again the power portion, will go to the induction motor or AC motor. Whatever is your AC motor that you are trying to employ. Now, I have to sense these three phase currents. So I'm just showing it like a circle. I have to put a current transformer, maybe some other type of sensor, whatever it is. So what I will have is about tens of amperes of current, maybe hundreds of amperes of current, but it has to be stepped down. Because most of the electronic circuits can handle only milliamperes or millivolts. So it has to be stepped down, and then those three currents have to be given here. These are the three-phase currents I have sensed. So IA, IB, IC, what I am talking about are actual currents. These are actual currents. And these are reference currents. The reference currents I am showing by star, and the actual currents I am sensing directly from the motor drive, which is connected to the inverter, right? Now, only thing that has not been shown is, from here, I have to put a TACO generator or whatever to sense the speed. So I'm going to sense the speed from here. So this is a complete closed loop control. How it is normally implemented in an AC motor drive with VSI. But of course, current is being controlled. So I am also monitoring the current in this particular case. Please note, here we are just not bothered about the current at all. In the previous scheme, we have not bothered about current at all. So by chance, if there is a problem, there is no protection. Whereas here, at least I am monitoring the current. So I could send this to your protection circuit and so on and so forth to make sure that if there is a problem, the motor is at least protected. Right? So I would be able to do that. So much so for the control of motor using VSI and current control VSI. Any questions on this? Because yesterday I had left it, you know, kind of hanging. So I thought, let me probably tie up the knots. That's it. Okay, any questions on this? If this is clear, then we will go over to space vector modulation technique. I gave a small introduction yesterday for this. So continuing from there, in space vector modulation, what I told you was, we are not going to look at all the three-phase voltages independently. VA, VB, VC, we are not going to look at them independently. And because normally in a three-phase case, VA plus VB plus VC equal to zero, we are essentially looking upon them as only two independent variables, not three independent variables. So we would like to convert them into two variable form rather than three variable form. So what I told you was, if I'm going to have A, B and C like this, I'm going to rather choose one alpha axis along this, one beta axis along this, and then I'm going to represent VA, VB, VC together as V alpha plus J V beta. So it is a simple complex number, or a single complex number, which actually we are representing all the three phase voltages with. So this I can say as space vector V, angle some theta, whatever is the theta. So this is essentially in polar form. I'm representing the entire all three phase voltages together. Okay, please note, I have mentioned B as though it is leading A. So I don't know, you guys have not noticed this. But we generally take this form only because of one particular reason. Otherwise, we always take B is lagging. We never take B as leading. This we have taken because if you look at any of the AC motors, especially when it is working as a generator, AC machine when it is working as a generator, normally we take actually, say the magnet is going to rotate in anti-clockwise direction, right? So if I have A here, it will face A first, then B first, then C next. So I will have, when the stator windings are stationary, that is what is actually my output voltage that is coming from, I will always have the arrangement in such a way that this is A, this is B and this is C, because the other member is rotating. So I am essentially making this with reference to machines, where the AC machines will normally have the arrangement somewhat like this. First, you will have A, then 120 degrees plus 120 degrees shifted, you will have B, and another plus 120 degrees shifted, you will have C. That is how normally AC machines' windings are there, because the windings which are actually generating the voltage will be put in stator. And the rotor is the one which is actually having the field system or magnet. So I have taken essentially ABC like this, as simple as that. Okay? So if I am going to have ABC voltages, ABC axis like this, I'm going to represent V alpha and V beta somewhat like this. Now, if I look at the normal three-phase inverter, right, I'm again taking the three-phase inverter, VSI, and I'm going to have a VDC on this DC link, and this is going to be again 1, 4, 3, 6, 5, and 2. So this is C phase, this is B phase, and this is A phase. If I assume that three devices conduct at a time in this inverter, I essentially had to have either 1, 2, 3, 2, 3, 4, 3, 4, 5, and so on. That is the way they will conduct in sequence, if I try to talk about it in sequence, right? So I will always have at least one device from the upper portion and one or two devices from the lower portion. Again, one or two devices from the upper portion and one or two devices from the lower portion. Obviously, both devices in the same leg will not conduct at the same time. So, if I say that if A phase positive device is on, I'm going to call that as 1 for A phase. If A phase negative device is on, I'm going to call that as 0. So, I'm going to say either every one of the phases will occupy either one position or zero position, depending upon whether the upper device conducts or lower device conducts. Okay. Now, if I am talking about, for example, 1, 2, 3 as the combination, I want to write A, B, C. So I better write 1, 3, 2, because 3 belongs to B phase, 1 belongs to A phase, and 2 belongs to C phase. So I will write this basically as 1, 1, 0. You get my point, because A phase, positive device, 1. B phase, positive device, which is 3, that will also be indicated by 1 corresponding to B phase, and 0 is corresponding to C phase. So I am writing A, B, C like this. So similarly, let me write for one more, 2, 3, 4. I should write, first of all, 4 first, then 3 will come, because 4 belongs to A phase, 3 belongs to B phase, 2 belongs to C phase. I should be able to write 0, 1, 0. So like this, I should be able to write all the 6 combinations. Right? Okay. So if I, first of all, the first combination I'm going to take out is 6, 1, 2. So let me write for that. 6, 1, 2 will correspond to 1, 6, 2. So I should be able to write this as 1, 0, 0. So this will belong to 1, 0, 0. This is 1, 0, 0. A, B, C will be 1, 0, 0. Now for each of these combinations, I want to see what the corresponding space vector is. For each of these combinations, I want to see what is the space vector is. Please recall how we drew A phase, B phase, and C phase voltages like this. This is A, this is B, and this is C. If I take that 6, 1, and 2 conduct at this point in time, I'm starting off with this. If I say 6, 1, and 2 conduct, think about it like what we did in commutation overlap. It is almost similar. So I have DC voltage, I have 1 is conducting, so this is 1, and I will have A phase load connected here, right? This is the A phase terminal. Now from here, I'm going to have B phase and C phase, because both of them are even devices, even number devices. So I'm going to have B phase and C phase, and I'm going to have, this is corresponding to 6 and this is corresponding to 2. So I'm just closing these two and I'm going to have a connection like this. This is the equivalent circuit when I'm talking about only 6, 1 and 2 are conducting. You get my point? Now, if I try to look at this, all the three phase loads are balanced. That's what I'm assuming. If it is a motor or any kind of load like connect, generally they will be balanced. So if I try to look at this current, right, as I, it will divide itself into I by 2 and I by 2 here. Whatever is the current that is flowing will be I by 2. So I will have essentially 2 by 3 VDC being the voltage here, and 1 by 3 VDC being the voltage here. Like 180 degree conduction mode, what we did, I'm essentially talking about the same thing. Three phase inverter, when we talked about 180 degree conduction mode, this is how we wrote. Please note the current is flowing in this direction, so this is plus and this is minus. I would say this is neutral. and this will be plus and this will be minus as far as these two phases are concerned. And we always talk about the voltage of A, B, C terminals with respect to neutral. So I have to take the direction into consideration, right? So if I say during this condition, I'm going to have this as maybe 2 by 3 VDC. This is VA. If I try to look at VB, VB is minus 1 by 3 VDC. And VC is also minus 1 by 3 VDC. So I have to write, this is minus 1 by 3 VDC, which is corresponding to, I should say rather this is plus 1 by 3 VDC, but it is in the opposite direction of normal B. Similarly, this is again 1 by 3 VDC, which is corresponding to the opposite of the normal direction of VC. So I have these three voltages now put together and I have to add them to get the space vector finally, right? So when I add them, I will get, this will be 60 degrees. This will also be 60 degrees. I hope you understand that, right? Because 120 half of 120 it will be. So I will get essentially 1 by 3 VDC times cos 60 for B phase. Again, 1 by 3 VDC cos 60 for C phase. And then 2 by 3 VDC, which is corresponding to A phase. So overall, the summation will be along this direction itself, but it will be VDC. Because 2 by 3 VDC plus 1 by 3 VDC multiplied by cos 60, which is half. Again, 1 by 3 VDC cos 60, which is half. So I will get essentially VDC itself. So I'm going to get this as VDC. And it is along the direction of A phase itself. Okay? We will do this for one more combination from which we can infer further results. So if I try to do it for the next combination, which is actually 1, 2, 3. When 1, 2, 3 conduct. Right? Please note that now on the positive side, there will be two elements. Because 1 and 3 both belong to positive side. And 2 is corresponding to the negative side. So by observation itself, I should be able to say that VC will be minus 2 by 3 VDC because 2 corresponds to VC. Whereas I'm going to have VA and VB, both of them being plus 1 by 3 VDC. Right? This is how they are going to be. Right? Is this clear? Because we are talking about only one device in the negative direction and two devices in the positive direction. So I'm going to have essentially, this is 1 by 3 VDC along this, and this is also 1 by 3 VDC. Whereas VC, which is in the opposite direction in this way, I have to take the opposite. So I have to take it this direction. So I'm going to have 2 by 3 VDC corresponding to minus VC. Now I have to add all these three, right? So I will have actually the resultant coming along this direction, which will be again VDC. Am I correct? So when I switch over from 612 to 123, I have got the same magnitude of space vector, voltage space vector, but it has shifted by 60 degrees ahead. So obviously, if I try to analyze for the next combination, which will be 2, 3, 4, you would see that it is ahead by another 60 degrees. 3, 4, 5 will be another 60 degrees ahead. 4, 5, 6 will be another 60 degrees ahead. So I have six combinations. Correspondingly, I will have six space vectors like this. So I would say, this corresponds to 612, this corresponds to 123, this will correspond to 234, this will correspond to 345, this will correspond to 456, and this will correspond to 561. So I'm going to have essentially six specific space vectors generated by the 6 combinations of the inverter switches, right? So I have only finite voltages that could be generated in the form of space vector. But I may require any other voltage. So how do I do the generation? How is it possible to generate any other voltage which is coming in between? That is the crux of space vector modulation algorithm, basically. So if I by chance turn on all these three together, 1, 3, 5, which will be a combination which will correspond to 1, 1, 1. Or if I turn on all these three things together, which will correspond to 0, 0, 0. I will get essentially zero voltage because I'm not going to get any voltage. All the negative terminal is connected to all the three faces, or the positive terminal is connected to all the three faces. So these will result in zero voltage vector. Whereas rest of the combinations, whatever we have talked about, that is 6, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, and so on and so forth, all of them are going to result in a combination which is a non-zero voltage vector and distinct voltage vector which are occupying 60 degree interval position, basically, right? So if I want, let us say, out of these 6 combinations that I have taken, right, I have got based on the voltage vector, let us say I want a voltage somewhat like this to be generated. Maybe VA is some 15 volts, VB is some 25 volts, and VC is minus 40 volts. I'm just saying. Maybe at this instant, I want a voltage which is corresponding to VA equal to 15 volts, VB equal to 25 volts, and VC has to be minus 40 because all the three of them added together will get zero ultimately, right? So if I am going to have a voltage to be generated like this, I call this as the reference value of voltage that I want to generate so that appropriate current flows through the inverter and then probably the motor, and then appropriate torque is generated. So I will nullify the speed error. That's what I'm looking at. So I would generate the reference value of voltage corresponding to which value the nullification of the speed error will happen. That's what I'm trying to look at. So let us say this happens to be some V reference delta. I have calculated what is VA, VB, VC, from which I should be able to calculate what is V reference along with its phase angle delta, right? Once I have calculated this, I have to check how to generate this voltage with these finite combination of V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6. These are the finite combinations which correspond to, again, 6, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, and so on and so forth, right? Yeah. Yeah, reference value you may be able to calculate if you go back to the closed loop control what I have drawn, right? Here I have said that you will generate the reference current, IA, IB, IC. Those currents, if I multiply by the motor impedance, right, I should be able to generate what is VA, VB, VC, right? So if I know the motor impedance, and maybe the back EMF has to be known also, because impedance multiplied by the current plus the back EMF will give me what should be the voltage applied in A phase. Same thing I have to do it for B phase and C phase. So I should be able to do it at least theoretically, right? It's a matter of detail how we will really calculate, which we will deal with in drive course, not right now, okay? So we will be able to calculate for sure what is VA, what is VB, what is VC, from which I am actually calculating the V reference along with the angle, okay? Now, I am going to have essentially, if I try to actually apply V1 for some time and V2 for some time, this is V1, along with V1, I have to put a scaling factor, clearly, because it's V1 vector which is exactly along, you know, that direction itself, but the length is smaller. So I have to put a scalar multiplication clearly. Similarly, I have V2 which is parallel to my original V2, but I have to put a scalar multiplication. What I want is V reference, but I will not be able to give V reference directly. I have to give it as a linear combination of two available voltages. There is no other option because I have only 6 combinations of voltages possible. Nothing more than that. So I have to make do with whatever is available with me ultimately to create the voltage reference I wanted finally. Now, I will not be able to really calculate exactly what should be that scalar factor unless I bring in the time. So I am going to actually sense the speed every now and then. If you actually look at the closed loop control once again, right? I am feeding the speed repeatedly, but the speed error has to be calculated. From that, the current has to be calculated. Then the hysteresis current controller has to check whether the current has exceeded or it is less. Then the switches have to be turned on and turned off. So there will be a finite delay between the time at which the speed is sensed and the actual correction is implemented. So there is no point in sensing the speed continuously. I have to definitely say, maybe I have sensed the speed now, wait for 100 microseconds to maybe take place. All these operations have to take place. After 100 microseconds, let me check the speed again, whether I have reduced the error or not. So that particular duration is generally known as the sampling duration. I am sampling the speed every now and then, right? Similarly, I will sample the current every now and then. There is no point in monitoring it continuously, because even if I monitor it continuously, I have to do all the calculations and all the computations are going to take some time. So obviously, I have to settle for this V reference value at least for that 100 microseconds. Okay, I have calculated. Let me apply this and see what happens to the motor. That is the way I'm looking at it, right? Because I will not be able to calculate it in real time. Every 100 microseconds, for example, I will calculate this, okay? So I am calling that duration as the sampling duration. So I'm going to say TS is the sampling time corresponding to which I'm going to calculate repeatedly what is the voltage to be applied. So I have calculated it now. After 100 microseconds, I'll calculate it again. After 100 microseconds again, I'll calculate. So, this V reference will remain as a constant for that 100 microseconds. I will not have any updation within that 100 microseconds. So, I would say I'm going to equate the volt second area. V reference multiplied by TS. Angle delta. Right? This has to be equal to V1 angle 0, of course, right, multiplied by some T1. For how long I have to apply, I don't know. I have to calculate clearly. And I have to say V2, of course, it is VD angle 60. That is what is V2, right? So I can call this as V2 or directly V1 angle 60, which is corresponding to V2. This is corresponding to V2. Multiplied by T2. Yeah, complete processing time, let us say, is 50 or 60 microseconds. See, there are several things that are involved here. One is turning on and turning off of the devices. That will take a finite time. Second thing is computation time. The third thing is even the sensors will require some time. It has to sense, and then it might be converted from analog value into digital value. So A to D converter will have a finite delay. So I will have so many delays, and I'm accumulating everything and saying that until all these processes are over, I will have the V reference value staying put at that particular. So I'm calling that as the sampling time, right? So updation takes place only after sampling time. I am essentially saying that V reference has to be applied only for a particular duration of time, TS. So ultimately, I have to find a way to calculate that scalar. I am using the scalar as the time, as simple as that. I am looking at essentially V1 plus V2 equal to Vref in this particular case. But it is not complete V1. It is V1 in the same direction multiplied by a scalar. You get my point? See, V1 is of this length, which is corresponding to Vd. But what I am using is a smaller length. Maybe 50%, maybe 30%. I am reducing the amplitude of, I want to reduce the amplitude of V1. So it is in one sense like a duty ratio. As simple as that. We are using it like a duty ratio. T1 by TS is my duty ratio for V1. T2 by TS is my duty ratio for V2. Get my point? Right? So we are using the same duty ratio concept here, yes. But we are having an angular quantity. See, you have to understand that VA plus VB plus VC when I add is instantaneous quantity. Small VA, small VB and small VC added together should make up for zero. If that had been the case for the space vector itself, then we would not get any revolving magnetic field in induction mode. It will all die. You understand? Because of the angle, that 120 degree shift, that is the reason why we are getting a finite revolving flux, right? That's why in a three-phase transformer, we don't have a revolving flux. Three-phase transformer, the windings are cophasal. They are not shifted. So we will not get any revolving flux. You get my point? That's why if I have a middle limb in a three-phase transformer, see, it's very essential to connect all the courses that you have studied. You can't say, I have finished machines, I will forget it. No way. You guys have to connect everything. So if I talk about a three-phase transformer, normally you are going to have a middle limb, right? This is one limb. This is probably the second limb. And the third limb will go like this. I'm not drawing it very well. In the middle limb, the flux will be zero. It will be zero because I'm essentially not shifting the windings. So IA plus IB plus IC has to be zero, because of which the middle limb essentially will carry hardly any flux, right? So that's what you are talking about. Get my point? So now, because of the spatial shift, we are not getting the space vector to be zero. It will be zero only in the case of 1, 1, 1 and 0, 0, 0. So coming back to this, I can look at T1 and T2 as the duty ratios corresponding to V1 and V2. And, yes. Exactly. Exactly. Because whatever is the closest, for example, if my V reference had been lying somewhere here, then I would choose these two, this and this. Whatever is the closest to two space vectors, that is what I will choose to create the linear combination so that I ultimately get my V reference. You get my point? So this is what we are going to do. So here, because the length is smaller, I may not be able to apply the voltage for so long. So I might have to resort to applying zero voltage for some time. If V reference happens to be only 40 volts, whereas VDC happens to be 100 volts, there is no way probably I would be able to cover up for the entire duration of TS. So I can introduce one more variable here, saying that V0 multiplied by T0, because that is essentially like a buffer. whatever is the excess time that is available, that will be taken care of by this T naught. And ultimately, I have to necessarily have T1 plus T2 plus T naught equal to Ts. If you try to solve for it, you will see that the magnitudes may not be able to match ultimately. T1 and T2 together may not make up for Ts. If you try to apply the voltage for too long, then probably you are overshooting. You are trying to essentially overshoot beyond whatever is the speed error. You may generate a much higher current, you may generate a much higher torque, the speed will overshoot or undershoot. So generally we will require a buffer duration. Maybe I will take some example problem for this. We will try to work out something, then it may become clearer. Okay, I'll try to pull out some problem, because we implement this all the time, but we don't do it numerically. We try to sit and implement it in actual DSP and it works fine, but I have really not done any numerical problem. I'll have to probably look for something. So let me try to now equate essentially the cos delta and sin delta portion, that is the real and the imaginary portion. So I can say this is V reference cos delta. This entire portion is V reference cos delta. So I can say V reference cos delta multiplied by Ts will be equal to, first of all, I will have V1 multiplied by T1 plus I have to have V2 multiplied by cos 60. Do you understand? This is 60 degrees, right? So it will be V2 multiplied by cos 60 multiplied by T2, right? Second thing I'm going to get is Ts multiplied by V reference sine delta, right? That will be equal to, I don't have any contribution from V1. Just a second. V2 multiplied by sine 60 multiplied by T2. Yeah. V0 is either if I make 1-1-1 combination, which is going to yield zero voltage. Zero voltage. Exactly. It may not be equal. If it is equal, well and good. Fantastic. You don't have to apply zero vector. But invariably, what we get as V reference cannot exceed VD, because what we have is only VD. So invariably, what you get as V reference will be smaller, generally smaller than VD. So you have to make do with another quantity which will correspond to zero voltage vector. Right? So I'm going to have T1 plus T2 plus T0 equal to Ts. So these are the three equations from which I'll be able to solve for the duty ratios, I would say, corresponding to V1, V2 and V0. Right? And if I am saying I have to apply V1, I know I have to go with the 6-1-2 combination. If I have to apply V2, I have to go with 1-2-3 combination. And if I have to apply V0, I have to go with either 0-0-0 or 1-1-1 combination. Yeah.
So we can apply them in any order, or it is
very good question. Excellent question. He's asking, should we apply them in the order V1, V2 and V0? Or V0, V1, V2, or the other way around. We have to follow a few conditions. Very, very, very good question, because I, as a student, I have never thought of this question, I should say, definitely. And then when I read more and more books, I realized why they choose a particular combination. Okay? If I am going to have 6-1-2, what is the kind of combination I have? This is essentially 1 and then 0, 0, right? If I have 1, 2, 3, I'm going to have essentially 1, 1, 0. Between these two, there is only one device that is changing. That is, only B phase device is changing its status from 0 to 1. If I try to jump to, from here, I try to apply V naught, which is corresponding to 1, 1, 1, for example. Two devices are changing their states. You get my point? And if two devices are changing the state, how much ever I may employ uniform devices, they are all manufactured by the same manufacturer, same batch, everything, still there will be slight difference in terms of turn on time and turn off time. So there will be something like a debouncing effect. I don't know whether you have heard of this term. Whenever I switch on any mechanical switch, it doesn't go in one go to turn on. Very often it will actually go through some oscillation before it is stuck in on condition or off condition. That is actually deadly in a semiconductor, because you are going to change the voltage, you know, very quickly, fiercely. That is really not a good thing at all. So normally what we tend to do is, only one switch should change its state at a time, not multiple number of switches. So I may choose instead 0, 0, 0. Then in that case, only one combination, one change occurs, and this is also changing only here. So normally what we try to do is to go from one combination of switch to the next combination, such that only one particular leg changes its state from 0 to 1 or 1 to 0. But after doing this application of this V reference, in the next sampling time, I don't know really what is going to be my V reference. It may be completely different. Maybe the motor has gained a lot of speed. Maybe something has changed drastically. So the next V reference might lie in a diametrically opposite side. This was my V reference. If suddenly my V reference is lying in a diametrically opposite side, I may have to go from 0, 0, 0 or 1, 1, 0 to suddenly 0, 1, 1. That is deadly. So that is the reason normally what they tend to do in any of these space vector implementation is, they will try to start from 0, 0, 0. They will go to 1, 0, 0. Then they will implement 1, 1, 0. Then they may give 1, 1, 1. Again 1, 1, 0. So what you have as T1, T2 and T0, they will try to divide it into 7 segments. 7 segments. Normally this is a 7 segment implementation. We call this a 7 segment implementation. So what we try to do is, let us say this may be T0 by 4. This may be T0 by 2. Then again from 1, 1, 0, I'll go to 1, 0, 0, then 0, 0, 0. Let us say. So this will be again T0 by 4. So these three add up together to T0. Now similarly, 1, 0, 0 and 1, 0, 0. So let us say 1, 0, 0 corresponds to this 6, 1, 2. So I will be able to call this as T1 by 2. This is also T1 by 2. Then this will be T2 by 2. This will be T2 by 2. So you start from 0, 0, 0 and end in 0, 0, 0. So the next one, if it happens to be completely 1, 1, 1, we will not try to adopt 1, 1, 1. Instead, we will try to adopt 0, 0, 0 itself for 0 voltage vector. See, this is helping because of the fact that you are not switching more than one leg at a time. All the three devices will switch, get switched. By chance, if let us say A phase device switches before the B phase, what will happen? A phase will become 1. B phase will still be 0. So you are not applying 0 vector. You are thinking you are applying 0 vector. 1, 1, 1 means 0 vector. But that is not 0 vector. You have 1, 0 and 0. So that is deadly, because you are thinking of doing something, but you are doing something else. You get my point? See, his question was, if you choose from 0, 0, 0, if you try to go to 1, 1, 1, let it go, what is the problem? Both are 0 vectors. But if I try to switch from 0, 0, 0 to 1, 1, 1, in the process, this is switching properly, the other two phases are maybe taking some more time. Then I will get essentially 1, 0, 0 as an in-between state, which is a non-zero voltage vector, which is deadly, because I didn't mean to apply that, but I'm applying that. So generally, we will never ever have a combination which will allow me to switch more than one phase at a time. I would like to switch only one phase state at a time. 0 to 1 or 1 to 0, I will transfer only in one particular phase. So this generally we call as 7-segment implementation. So there may be other types of implementation that might have been there, but I have seen in some of the books and research papers this kind of implementation. So I just told you one of the methods. There may be definitely other types of implementations that are possible. So much so for space spectrum modulation. So I have finished the class earlier than what I intended to, because I don't want to start the CSI today. CSI we'll start on Thursday. Before we conclude, Apoor Dhankar was telling me that some of you guys didn't want Friday's class so late. Rather than that, you guys wanted to have Monday's class itself, regular class. If it is okay with you all, I will have Monday's class. I don't have a problem. How is it? What do you guys want to do? You tell me, because then I'll have to cancel the booking of that room. How many of you vote for Monday? Let me see how many of you are. Okay, put down your hand. How many of you for Friday? Friday is definitely a minimal number. Looks like. Good for me too. I don't want to really do it late in the evening. But I meant to actually give you snacks on that day. I'll have to give you some other day. That means today I didn't order, unfortunately. I would like to postpone it to the last class so that everybody will be around. Otherwise, people will not come. Once I conduct the quiz, I am very sure of that. But that is not guaranteed though. I hope you guys have marked your attendance. If you have not,